Hi, I'm Happy Charisma Encouragement. Go, girl! No better than she was before. Then I say, oh, well, maybe I don't have the charisma encouragement.
I don't know what your favorite superheroes are, but I had seen a movie one year called X-Men First Class. And they had these freaky abilities, and they were kind of embarrassed about them. And the whole movie is them learning through Professor X how to channel them, how to do something with them. And what I was struck by is when they finally had them under control, each of them were able to fly. Even though their gifts were nothing like each other's, they could do something and it would make them fly. And I thought, that's fantastic. So right now we're gonna fly. We're gonna find your superpowers. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. Dear Lord God, help us know the gifts, the superpowers that you've given us to serve you, to bring others to you. We thank you so much for our time together. We ask that this talk tonight be in your glory. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. As it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. St. John Paul II,
pray for us.
All of your patron saints,
pray for us.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. This information comes from the Called and Gifted program by Sherry Waddell, and she's also known for the book Forming Intentional Disciples. She gives Called and Gifted workshops to kind of help people know what it is, to really know who we are in God's sight. So I give you her name and the title of this program. This is my name in school that we're opening August 14th, Feast of St. Maximian Kolbe, next August. Here we go. Superpowers, charisms. One thing is our gifts. Those are gifts that God has given us for our benefit. Another thing is our charisms. That's what God has given us for others' benefits. And so Ben and I had talked to each other at the friars, of the Franciscan friars at Levine. And it was clear to me that I needed to talk to him, and I didn't know why, but there's something in him that I thought, okay, then I need to go talk to Ben. And we talked and exchanged prayer intentions, and I thought, I wonder if he has a spiritual charism of intercessory prayer. And so I just sort of filed that away, and then, meanwhile, it ended up my coming here. The gifts, God will let me build up myself. The charisms, God has given me so that you would get His graces through me, and I'll get God's graces through you. And it's it makes me feel very cherished by God that He can use me to build up His kingdom. The three ways that I will know that I'm using a charism, and you will know it as well. When you're in the area of your charism, you might feel like a mud puddle, and then someone comes up to you and needs your charism from you. Encouragement or wisdom or pastoring or whatever. And for that moment, you fire up and you're on fire and you're telling them the stuff. And then the person walks away, back into a mud puddle again. But at that moment, you are full of energy. Can you think of a time that's happened to you? Okay, so be aware of it so that when it happens to you in the future, you'll say, I was energized. What did that person ask me to do? I wonder if that's superpower. I wonder if that's a charism. A second one, while you're actually in the act of giving that charism, of being the conduit for the grace to flow through you, because God is a God of peace, you will feel an insane peace and calm. You'll be so sure. The confidence is so clear. Of course this is the answer. And because it's God working, when you're actually working in the area of your charism, whatever it is you're doing will work. It will work, because all things are possible with God. So you'll be energized, you'll be calm, and it will be effective. And so you can sort of know, I tried something, I really thought God was meaning me to do it, but it didn't seem to have any result. So maybe that's not an area. So these are things, just keep this in the back of your mind when we do all the rest of what we're gonna do. So let's plunge in. Before we plunge in, let me stop for questions. Any questions yet? Okay. I'll give you two examples so that you know what we're going to talk about. One day I was getting on the plane, and I was walking down, you know, in that awkward way that we walk down planes that can barely fit, and of course with me I get stuff caught. And so as I'm walking and squeezing, all of a sudden I squeeze past this guy and he stops me and he says, "Sister, thank God you're on the plane." I said, "Thank you." He said, "I need you to pray that our house will sell. We just listed it." And he's going through these details. And I looked at him, and meanwhile the whole concourse is filling up behind me wondering what on earth. And I said, "What's your name?" He tells me. I said, "What's your wife's name?" He tells me. I said, "Well, let's pray right now." And the people behind me, ah! How did that man know to ask me? I don't know. But the charism was for him. And so when I passed, he thought, "Oh, you're the one. Hey, I need something from God. And you'll be the one who will give it to me." Something else, as we're going through the charisms, one thing is our natural abilities, and another thing is the spiritual charism, the spiritual gift that's from God. Music. Let's start with music. A person has studied, she's a concert pianist, she's spectacular. She has a natural talent for music. Another guy, he learns three chords, and he starts singing it, praise and worship, and I don't know why, but everyone starts to cry, and their hands go up, and their hearts are moved, and he's not a great musician, but his music opens a portal or a door to God. That's the charism of music, as opposed to the talent of music. Does that make sense? Okay, so now we're gonna go for it. As we go, you know, chime in, pitch in, ask, does that mean this? Administration sounds boring. It's not. It's the person who loves to organize, put labels on things, set things in alphabetical order, spices all in the rack. And when he or she does that, she is spiritually energized. She becomes a whole new person. She has a whole peace. Those of you who have that, you should be excited. It's a superpower. You thought you were just being annoying. This is a very special one. Celibacy is the superpower, the spiritual superpower, to remain chaste for love of God. One thing you should know about charisms is they won't ever change. You have them. They're yours. Those of you who are called to married life, by definition, you don't have the charism of celibacy. And you won't be married and a leader and wake up in the morning and be a celibate house. You know, it just won't change like that, because this is also part of your vocation. Now, there are those who take a vow of celibacy, and they do it through grace and the strength that God provides. But there are some for whom, because of this charism, is spiritually fruitful, it spiritually gives life. And perhaps for those people, it's even slightly easier to keep their vow of chastity. Spectacular, very beautiful one. Can you think of a saint who had it? I'm thinking, of course, of Saint Kateri, take it with them. You're thinking maybe of Saint Maria Goretti, or you're thinking maybe of Saint Agnes. Men have it too. Dominic Savio probably had it. Beautiful saints. Craftsmanship. A sister who's in the back of the room here has this one. It's a skill with the hands that can make something artful, beautiful, using scissors, a bit of string, and some glue, or whatever happens to be at hand. And whatever it is raises the mind to God. And there are those who are knitters, and all of a sudden everyone's happy being in your presence while you're knitting. Isn't that funny that that could be an actual charism, that you could give a peace and a joy when you're doing that? Some of you who are bakers or cooks, you might have actually a spiritual charism of cooking, of craftsmanship. Isn't that amazing to think that God could use you? And you've seen that, the ability of a good meal to bring everyone together and to settle difficulties, to warm hearts, to turn people toward each other. That's why our Lord, of course, comes to us in the Eucharist in the form kind of a meal. St. Therese had this. I should have made you guess who this was. St. Therese had this charism. She is appearing in her role as, can you tell what character she's playing? She's already a nun, and she's got a wig over her veil. She's playing the warrior saint, Joan of Arc. Isn't that wonderful?
This is a play she put on for the other sisters when she was already in Carmel. And so through her ability to make things, she was able to bring great joy and spiritual refreshment to her sisters in Carmel. Discernment of spirits is a pretty rare charism. The first three, well, celibacy, I don't know how rare it is. Administration's pretty common. Craftsmanship's pretty common. This one's pretty rare. And if you have it, go check in with the friars or someone to be sure that you do. The discernment of spirits is the ability to know, to sense a spirit in the room, to sense if it's an evil or a holy spirit, to discern the good spirit from the bad spirit before the fruits of the spirits are manifest. And as I say, it's pretty rare. All of us can tell there by the results. We can always tell what spirit has been working at us, but some people can tell as they're coming. It happened one day, we were in a class, and there was a girl sitting about where you are, and she, I was teaching, I think, about charisms, actually, and she, all of a sudden, and I thought, oh, something happened. And I went up to the boy who was right here, and I said, start praying the rosary, don't stop. So that I could keep teaching, and then her face kind of calmed a little. I didn't know what she had seen, I didn't know she had this, I didn't know anything, but I just knew something had happened in the room by looking at her face, because she knew. Then this fellow, turns out he has a charism of intercessory prayer. I didn't know that, but I did know to go to him to ask him. Start praying while I teach this lesson. So it's a wonderful thing. Do I have a picture of who had it? Oh, yes. Before you guess who this is his youthful picture. Can you guess what saint he grew up to be? Italian? Stigmata? Absolutely. This is our favorite, Padre Pio. And he had it, of course, most abundantly. Encouragement. There are many fellows with this charism. And it's why I think a lot of times girls like to have friends who are guys. Because there are many guys that seem to have a charism of encouragement, which gives us heart for our daily labors, which is what encouragement means. No, you can go do it. You're fine. Go get that test. And then I'll meet you back here for coffee. There's something wonderful, and when it can be done on a natural level, we all encourage each other, but those of you who have the charism for it, when you say those words to us, it actually calms us, it gives us peace, we're ready to go, because you've said it. Pier Giorgio Frassati was the great friend, the great encourager. I hope you're seeing yourself. You can have 1, 2, 3, 4, maybe 5 of these charisms, depends on what God has lavished upon you, so I'm watching faces to see, as we go, if you want a question while we're on it might be a smart time to ask it. Okay. Evangelism. These are the people who have a burning zeal to take the gospel in a new way. I think a lot of the YouTube media people, the reason why you've gotten into what you're doing, the filmmakers and all, you may have this charism of evangelism because you're realizing, wait, there's a really great, powerful medium and I'm going to get in on it and fill it with the word of God. You might have a charism of evangelism. You're the person who has just, you happen to have a couple extra rosaries in your car, a couple of pamphlets, a couple of tapes, a couple of whatever, and you're just ready to say, hi, have you ever read Jesus' Discourse on the Bread of Life? It might make you help you understand the Eucharist, the Catholic Church. Want to come visit? Want to come pray with me? You may have this charism of evangelism. And you'll be energized as you're doing it. Everyone else is horrified and scared and they don't want to go. They'll go with you though. I'll go knock on doors if you're there. Why? Because you have the charism. That means it's going to work. Our saint for that is today's saint, St. John of Capistrano, who preached in Italy, Poland, Hungary, the Danube. It was a spectacular life of preaching. Faith. This quote, of course, is from Padre Pio, pray, hope, and don't worry. He had also the charism. He had many charisms, but one of his was also faith. He also had the charism of celibacy, etc. This is the person who gets into her car in California and drives to New Mexico with $25, knowing that God's going to get her there. It's going to work. And her mother and her father are furious. But she knows perfectly well it's totally going to work. It's the person who sees God's hand and calls on God as Father. And for her, it seems it's easier to trust him. And people who don't have it always, I think, are a tiny bit Gosh, I think your life is easier for you because you don't have to worry so much. No, because she has the charism of faith. This is a young version of our saint with this charism. Can you guess who she grew up to be? Pretty popular Italian doctor. Gave her life for her baby. This, of course, was St. Gianna Barettamola. There she is with two of her children. Her fourth child, when she was pregnant with her fourth child, she had a tumor. And they said, well, we can do surgery, but you'll lose the baby. She says, well, then you're not doing surgery. And then it was right up to the time of delivery. She said, if you have a choice between saving me or saving the baby, I command you to save the baby. She had a great faith. Generosity. You may be too young to know if you have this yet. The problem with charisms is that it kind of takes some things to be able to give away to know if you have generosity. But you've seen it in your parents or your grandparents or your uncle or someone who always is having everybody over, giving everything down to the last penny. Why is she mortgaging her house again? Well, because she has the charism of generosity. She just keeps giving. And somehow God still helps her pay all the bills. Did I have someone? Yeah. This is her in her younger years, and a famous social activist, atheist to start with, and then a communist, and then, of course, becomes the great work he did. There she is. Spectacularly generous, a charism of generosity.
I'm sorry.
Healing. I do not have this charism, and I was very bitter that I did not have it. I do not have a lot of these. I have some. Healing is the ability to connect God's healing power with the person who is ill. And when that person speaks the word of God to this person who is ill, life and health is brought to that person, that God has chosen to use the healer as his mediator. God could heal instantly without him, without the healer, but he chooses to use the healer because he loves for us to be a part of his work. That's the whole thing about charisms. That's why we're so happy when we're using them. If you have this charism, be sure that you're reading the newspapers and reading about people who need healings, and please be using it. You'll be energized. You'll be at peace. It will work. People will have healings they won't even know where they're coming from, because this is one of the, it's slightly more rare than some people's. Helps. There are two, what I call service charisms. And this one is a specific way of serving. There's a charism called leadership, and that's coming. The person who has the charism of helps is actually designed, given a gift, to help a particular leader. So it would be wise to put those together on the same team, to work together. Because the leader will have this vision, and the helps person will put it into action. She'll be energized as she's coming up. The leader will say, I think we should do this and this, but I don't know quite how to set it in motion. And the helps person will say, oh, I know exactly how. Now, the cool thing about charisms is that though there is a charism of leadership, in our area of charism, we are leaders. We know exactly what to do because it's our superpower. And so when we're asked to do one of these things, it's not a leader's, but in that moment, oh, I know exactly what to do because the Holy Spirit's telling me, who knows all things. Really kind of exciting. And that'll be another sign that you have that charism, when you know, you just absolutely know what to do, kind of in the moment. So the helps person is able to help the individual leader. Hospitality, this is the person who opens his home, opens her home. She said, everyone's coming over, come into this house. My dad had this charism, and it was reflected in the fact that he had 10 kids of his own, and all the neighborhood kids were always over, and dad wanted them over, both probably to keep an eye on us, and also because he wanted them. He just loved them. And his sentence always was, come into this house. That sort of joy that he got of opening his home to others. Intercessory, yes?
How are generosity and hospitality different?
Generosity is a giving, hospitality is a welcoming gift. Great question. Some people have both. And in fact, for those two to be paired makes very good sense because the Holy Spirit is not wasteful. Yeah, and so it makes sense for the same person to have them both. Intercessory prayer, this is a very common charism, and any of you who've gone to the friars, you've felt it or you have it. So you've either been drawn there because you've been drawn to pray because you're a prayer, or because you know that you'll be interceded for. Intercessory prayer can work in different ways. It can be one person lifting up, I could be lifting you up to God, or I have, my version of this is actually, someone will tell me what needs to be prayed for, and then I know who to ask to pray for it. So I'm a kind of an intermediary. When someone else is also praying in a group, then it's a good time for me to join that group, join my prayer to theirs. So you'll learn, not only is there a charism, but there's ways that your charism is perfected. Let's see, did I put a person on this one? Okay, because many of us have it. Knowledge, this is the person who is energized, just goes nuts, reading even, you know, the encyclopedia, is really reading Wikipedia all the time, searching out all the links, and when she's doing it, she's making the synthesis, she's understanding what God did in creation. She's having a wild time in her mind. Very often, a person who has the charism of knowledge, where knowledge is coming in, will also have a charism of preaching, teaching, or writing, or encouragement. So they take that knowledge and they give it to you in the form of encouragement. So you can kind of see, if I have one, I might have this other one. And if all this time you always thought, man, I just waste my time chasing down useless information, well, maybe you are, but maybe you actually are feeding into your charism of knowledge. So you can be praying about that and seeing. And what's the test? How will you know if it's a charism? You'll feel energized, you will feel peaceful, and it will work. It'll be effective. Nice. Okay. A fellow who had this charism very well, he's actually still alive. Look at his cute, isn't he cute? Look at his big ears. Who did he grow up to be? Pope Benedict. See his cute big ears? And he is a fantastic example of the charism of knowledge. And then also, he clearly has the charism of teaching to be able to give it once he's gotten the knowledge himself. Leadership. So there are leaders that have natural gifts. Then there's the charism of leadership, where when they're leading, they're able to articulate a vision that actually unites the people on the team. And it's a powerful gift, and it can transcend, you know, men who normally don't like to follow a woman would follow a woman who has the charism of leadership, no problem, because God is leading. I think I have a person here, right? Yes, so here he is as a baby, and who did he grow up to be? Yes, I know. Now, did you notice how you reacted? Why did you do that? Because he has a charism of leadership. He's not just asked to be a leader. Did you notice how you didn't ooh for Pope Benedict? Because he doesn't have the charism of leadership. He had the charism of teaching and preaching. Oh, and so that's why when he was leading, we were happy campers. Okay. Mercy, you already know who's the picture's gonna go up there, so let's just put her up. Here she is as a young girl, guess. Obviously, Mother Teresa. Yeah, and I won't even say any more because there was the walking example of mercy, and any part of that that you have, please live it, because you saw that she converted half a world, half a continent, by exercising her superpower of mercy. Notice that she didn't save she didn't save 10,000 people at once. She reached out to this man and picked him up. Then she reached out to this man and picked him up. She picked up one person at a time. So when you go, those of you who have the charism of mercy, go about it one person at a time. This is a good time to also add, just because we don't have the charism, we're not off the hook. All of us who don't have the charism of mercy, we still have to do the corporal and spiritual works of mercy. It's just not going to be easy for us. Like the person who's kept the vow of celibacy, and the person who has the charism, well, one of them has it easier. Well, fine. Then they better do it better. They better do it shining light, the way she did mercy, with a shining light. But all of us have to do works, corporal and spiritual works of mercy. The missionary. Okay. Some of you probably have it because you're in this club tonight, so I'm going to tell you your problem. The people with missionary charism are, by definition, always on the fringes of what's going on because they are a bridge maker. So they're almost not quite in this group, but they're holding on by a thread, and they're always reaching out to the people outside the group. And if you've ever felt that you don't belong, you don't quite fit, you very well may have a charism of a missionary, and that explains a lot. And it should make you feel better. You guys will say, oh, I love doing that, but I just feel like I'm not like everyone else. No, you're not. You're a missionary. It's a spectacular charism. And I'm seeing some smiles, so I think some of you are recognizing yourselves right there. Good for you. Good for you. Keep it up. Don't ever lose your founding in the Catholic faith, but at the same time, be reaching because you have the gift to reach in an effective way that will bring people to you. Good for you. I think I have a person here. Yes. This is not really, I don't really have that charism, but I'm just showing you, you know, as the people going in and mixing into cultures and so forth. Music, we talked about this charism, the person who has the talent, different from the person who has the ability by his or her music, people are raised up to God. Three more band, someone in that band has the charism. Maybe more than one of them in the band has the charism. And so when I'm with them, I pray better than I pray, a lot of other times. Pastoring. This is the charism. Now, this is not necessarily a male only. This is not having to do with the priesthood. But it's the ability to gather people together inside the church, not the church building, but inside the Catholic Church, Bible studies, Renew Your Parish, Alpha, Revive, whatever sort of fostering of trust, belonging, community, shepherding, kind of getting little ministries going and getting them pushed off, and probably being in the Catholic Club, someone here has it, maybe more than one. My example, Don Bosco. And of course, he organized all the boys into the little groups, and then he did, yeah. Prophecy, very rare charism. And in fact, at the Friars, they only let certain people speak word gifts because it has to have been discerned, etc. It's super rare. It's not necessarily for telling the future, it's telling the word of God. Now, we're never obliged to believe anything that's not public revelation. So if someone is saying something at a prayer meeting, we're not obliged to believe that that's from God. We're obliged to believe the Gospels and the teaching of the church. However, a person who has the charism of prophecy is giving a message of God to us. How do we know if it's really from God? It'll work. Now, we won't be energized when we hear it because the person who has the charism will be energized. It's the Holy Spirit running through her body, so it just filters with electricity, divine electricity, fine. I'm in hearing it, I may or may not have a sense of calm, a sense of peace, but that word, that sentence will work. I will see its fruits and I will say, that was a true prophecy. And our example, St. Bridget of Sweden. And of course she had the 15 revelations. She is such a spectacular ear to God and deliverer of that message to the various kings of Europe that she's actually the patron saint of all of Europe, not just one country. So it's very rare, and it's very wonderful. Service, this is super useful. All right, this will explain the rest of you. The service person is a person who's energized by getting out there, getting those chairs in a row, getting those lunches set up, get the food kitchen organized. And those of you who are just dying to death when you even think of that idea, you don't have a charism of service. And those of you who are so pumped up, let's make homeless shelter kits. Let's do, service people will see the need before the leader person knows there is one. And so then the leader person might get a little ticked because they say, what, you're just trying to take over my job? No, I'm sorry, I just all of a sudden. And that service person was energized when she realized a need that she could solve. And now see, we just explained the rest of you. Okay. But the difference between that person and the helps person, remember the helps is specifically helping the one leader. Service helps everybody, all the time, and is energized by it. Now, this is a good time to give you an insight I had when I was first hearing about these charisms. So, we're all basically good people, BGPs. Let's go around, you know, we don't kill anybody. Why is it always that? Anyway, we're basically good people, show up to Catholic Club and stuff. Well, basically good people have this disease. We don't say no when we should. So then we overschedule. So ladies, gentlemen, let's give you the secret. There are those of us who have very fast, reactive personalities. For example, Sister Mary Bridget. And when someone's starting up a volunteer Let's get 12 people to whatever. Well, of course, fast reactor, hand goes in the air, although I don't want to. And secretly, I don't have that charism. And so what I have learned is that it's this knowledge has given me permission not to say yes immediately. And here's what I do. I do this. Put my hand back down. Gather the rosary. I look over at the sister whom I know has the charism of service. But she's a slow reactor, so she's still processing the sentence. And then she gets to the end of the processing and she says, oh, I would love to do that. And the fact is she would. I mean, she would be thrilled to do it. I would be thrilled to let her. And then suddenly I'm not exhausted all the time anymore because I'm not doing stuff that I don't have a charism for. Now, am I going to help her? Yes. You see? Now, who's happy now? This is my favorite thing to find out. Oh, sister likes doing that. Administration too. When I realized that people love putting things in order and putting labels on them and all, and I thought, well, good for you. Rock on. You want to do mine next? Yay! Meanwhile, she's in like, God, you and I are united. Oh. Yes. Okay. Teaching. That's awesome. Okay, teaching. You know when someone has the charism of teaching because you learn. When you're receiving that much learning in one night, you're saying, oh man, that person has the charism of teaching. Thank God that's coming and not someone else. Okay, so the teacher is able to say something in such a way that her students will come back to her and say, I never understood that before. And then when you said it, now the teacher also has this weird thing. When you were teaching it, what I heard was, and it's nothing at all what the teacher said, but God used the time and the words coming out of the teacher's mouth to give a message to the student. The person who has this charism will also find herself speaking words she didn't know were going to come out. So she teaches herself at the exact same moment. And now some of you are saying, I might have a charism teacher because I've had that happen. Yes, you very well might. This is not rare. This is, and it's super needed in the 21st century. And you can do it in any which way. So here's one of our teachers, Sister Mae Gertrude, teaching this little girl is being the Blessed Mother. And so she's found a way to teach that's very interesting. Voluntary poverty, did you know that's a charism? There are people who are actually happy getting rid of everything to everything. Francis, the less I can have, the least possible. Let God alone suffice those people, where it is a joy to have nothing, to be totally dependent on the Lord. And I think I have Philip Neri.
Yeah.
Because the only thing he wanted was heaven. And I don't know if you've seen this movie, but if not, it's well worth seeing. Wisdom, we're down to the last two. Wisdom, this is different from knowledge. Knowledge comes from a person's own effort. Wisdom comes from God. The person puts herself in a position of prayer, reflection. Maybe she has a daily practice of reading the Bible. And then God's knowledge becomes part of her knowledge. It's a wonderful charism. And it's super helpful if a person with wisdom has the charism of teaching or writing, as you could imagine, or especially encouragement. Writing, before I put them up, of course, same thing with music. There's a talent for writing, and many people have a natural talent, and they've taught themselves, or they've been taught well. And then there are people who, when they write, God is all over the page. And we're thinking, of course, of my two favorite. We have G.K. Chesterton and J.R.R. Tolkien. And what's funny about Tolkien, when people read his stuff, I know, and we love him. Why are you having this reaction? Because he has a charism. So now when you read his stuff, you're saying, oh, is that what a charism is? It just took you straight to God when you read it. Now what's curious, people who read Tolkien who are atheists, at least one of my students who was an atheist, he was saying something about, he says, what is it about Tolkien, sister? And I said, his faith? No, I'm talking about his writing. I said, oh, of course you are. Yes, but his writing taught the faith, and that atheist couldn't put him down. Later he comes back and he says, so what is this? What is this limbus and all? I said, you know exactly what it is. It's the Holy Eucharist, right? He says, I knew you would say that.
I said, now Tolkien wasn't writing an allegory. He was not trying to do a one-on-one. He says so himself. It's just a story. He's trying to get people interested in his five elf and dwarf languages. No one wants to learn Quenya unless they learn, you know, read why they should know it. He didn't care a lick about the story. Isn't that funny? He just totally wrote the story so that people would pick up the Silmarillion and teach themselves the elves' languages. And of course, no one cares about the elf languages, and we run into the story. And the story makes us better people. It made the actors better people when you listen to their interviews. So that's all the charism. There's 24. What's your next step? I wanted you to know the names of them, because I need you to listen to people talking to you. And if someone says to you, wow, that's really wise, your ears should go, deep, 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 charism word, charism word. Someone received wisdom from you. Do I have a charism of wisdom? What do you start to do? Then you pray about it. Lord, do I have a charism of wisdom? Someone thought I said something wise, which is so rare. Then pay attention. The next time you say something that someone thinks is wise, did you feel energy at that moment? Did you feel peaceful at that moment? Did it work? Okay. Someone comes up to you and says, sister, I know you can do this. Would you be able to whatever for me? Where did that out of left field? And then see, when I did that stupid thing, okay, were you ready for example of a stupid thing? The lady comes up to me and she says, oh, hermana, por favor, you can play the piano. I said, I can't play the piano. She says, yes, you can. I know you can. I pray over you. I said, no, I can't play the piano. Look, I have the keys to the tower. I can turn on the sound tower, and we can put on, not the tower, but I can turn on the music. I thought they were quoting from Lord of the Rings. I didn't know. Okay. So she says, no, sis, no, por favor, I'm gonna por favor. And so then she prays over me. She says, you can play. So Sister Mary Jordan, she's sitting up on the stage, and I'm walking up, you know, like I know what I'm doing, which I don't. And I go up and I sit down and I play the few things I know. I know how to do a chord progression. Who doesn't, you know? So I'm doing that. Well, anyway, out of the corner of her mouth, Sister Mary Jordan leans over to the priest who's on the stage with her, and she says, sister doesn't play. He says, looks like she's going to. So I play, and then I slip off the stage, and I go find the other sister who actually has not only the gift of playing piano, but the charism. And I said, sister, you're in a position to do me a great kindness. Please come and finish this thing for me so that when they, you know, process out, you can play. She says, no. So I had to go back and finish the session. It was horrible. And so it confirms to me that I do not have what? The charism of music. Because it didn't work. It was a nightmare. Oh well. Anyone know what charisms you have? Do you know how to find them? Start to pray about them. Listen to people, because they're for people. They're not for you. Now, tie it back to X-Men First Class. When I first heard about these, I was dead. I was exhausted. I was miserable. I was so tired all the time. And they started talking about energy, energy, energy. I said, Tom, what is that? Whatever you're talking about that has energy involved, tell me about it. So they started talking about the charisms. And I said, I was energized just hearing about it. Wait, I don't have to be exhausted 24/7? There might be 2 seconds every day where I'm alive? Bring it! And so I started studying them. And then one time, sister said, we need the teachers to do such and such. But I'm not quite sure how do I get them to do that? And I said, I know exactly how. Because I had that charism of teaching. And so I was able to say, I know how to do it. And I did in that area. So things like that, when you find yourself using these words or words like them, and that all of a sudden you know what to do, and then you try it and it works, and ask the Lord, so is that a thing? Be alert to people telling you have it. There's an inventory that you can take. It's called the Spiritual Charisms Inventory that Sherry Waddell and her group is called the Siena Institute. You actually can do the workshop do the, there's interviews with it, there's a whole process of going through praying. It's not so easy as taking a Myers-Briggs personality disorder, but it starts that way, asking myself questions. But the reason why the questions are valid is because it says, people tell me that something I've made has given them joy. And the answers are never. One person has, two people have, three or many people have. And you just circle zero, one. Do you see what I'm saying? But it's because people are telling me. Why does it matter that people are telling me? Because who are charisms for? For them. So of course they're the ones telling me. If they're not telling me, it's because they're not a charism in it, which is helpful too. Questions?
So when did you find out about your charism?
2013, and I was so happy. Jean Five. She's laughing because she was there.
How did you come to discover that?
Well, so she and Sister Mary Gretty were having this discussion, and I'm taking down, oh no, it's back up. Sister Mary Gretty, he says, let's take down the tree. And I thought, I hate taking down the tree. Christmas is over. I'm over. I'm going to deep depression when we take down the trees. I don't want to do it. But they started having this discussion about charisms. Well, I wanted to hear that. And then the two of them stopped taking down the tree at all, and I was taking down by myself, just so I could listen to the charism conversation. So I took down the tree. And so then meanwhile, destroyed. Spiritually, because trees are good. Taking it down is dead. And then they're over there just talking it up. And I said, so where's that inventory? And she said, oh, it's right here, it's in my chapel stall. I said, so why am I not having it right now? And she says, well, I don't know. You need to pray, you need to prepare yourself. She says, I know you. You're gonna have in your head the charisms that you want to come out with, and then you're gonna come out with different charisms, you're gonna be unhappy. And I said, no, those aren't gonna happen, which is exactly what happened. I went down and I took them, and I said, oh, I want this one, And it's funny that she knew me that well. Now I tie it back to X-Men First Class. What I mean is this. He didn't want his feet to be hands. Dang! But of course, it turned out to be an enormous asset for him. She didn't want half her back to unwrap from her skin and all of a sudden become wings, but then it turns out she can fly. And that guy with the super high pitch thing, turns out if he ever echolocuted just right, he could fly. And the guy who was exploding things with fire from his hands, if he could control it, he could take down all the enemy weapons and then fly. Notice they don't figure out how to fly. Well, this will help us fly. Because I'm not volunteering for things that I'm no good at. I'm giving other people chances for them to grow spiritually. And I'm growing spiritually, and I'm exhausted every minute. So then I was bitter about my results. Just bitter. And I came back upstairs, and I looked at these guys, and I said, And the other sister says, you don't like them. I said, I like him, which I didn't. So then the next week I took it again. You know what I'm saying? I just took charisms. I just took the inventory again. Let me answer truthfully this time. No exaggerations. Well, it came out, exactly the same and even more clear. Those. And I just went, all right. So then it has a description of which saints have them, what they were able to do, how they were able to fly. And little by little, I started falling in love with them. And then I started seeing, wait, God knew this all along. So I'm going to tell you a very ridiculous story. It'll be my last one, unless you clamor for more. Once upon a time, I was entering the Dominican Sisters of Nashville. And I was a novice, which means I've already got my religious name, Sister Mary Bridget, I have my white veil, I'm in a habit, and Sister Mary Jordan and I are going for this walk, around the rosary walk. And I said to her, I said, Sister Mary Jordan, I figured it out. And she says, what? She's always interested in my weirdness, and she says, what? And I said,
So you know how everyone leaves in the morning and they have book bags? She says, yeah. I said, and you know how we get back and all the black veils, you know, they tell stories about the classrooms and teaching and all? She says, yeah. I said, this is the teaching order, isn't it? She went, I mean, how did you miss that? I said, no, I just didn't know. I didn't know, but I figured it out. I mean, we're all teachers, aren't we? She said, this is a teaching order. And I said, yep. And she said, yeah, you didn't know? I said, I didn't know. She said, you visited. I said, yeah. I said, you didn't know. I said, I didn't know. She says, why did you come to a teaching order? And I said, well, I don't know. I guess I had in mind a love affair with God. And she says, well, how does that change? By teaching. And I said, oh, yeah, didn't change at all. Okay, fine, I'm fine. And what was so funny was that if I had known it was a teaching order, I promise you I would not have gone. Because that's drudgery. Who wants to teach all that work? Those little snippy kids and all. And I love it. And I wouldn't trade it for anything, but I would never have chosen it. But God had given me the gift for it, and I would have never found it all my life. So he veiled it from me so that I would walk in blindly just out of love for him, and all of a sudden, we're teaching! And it turns out that that was the best thing I could ever do. Yeah. So I love how God works. Ask him to reveal to you your charisms, hopefully in a less dramatic way, but if you need it that way, fine, blindness works. Whatever he wants to do. Look, the number one way you're going to find your charisms is by spending lots of time in prayer and just being with God. The more you're with God, the more his will for you is clear. And as you discover your charisms and come to peace with them, that you have those and not others, you'll learn to fly. You'll learn how to use your particular charism in the most creative ways, and you will fly. And others will come to you and say, why are you so happy? Why are you so energized? And you'll say, because I know my superpowers. You want me to tell you yours? And then you'll have the next one. Thanks, Sean. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. All of the patron saints.
Pray for us.
In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen. Who's the patron saint of the Catholic Club?
St. John Paul II.
That's the other reason you all were thrilled to see this. Well, great. Oh my gosh, over time. But I think we didn't start so early on time, did we?
Thank you, sister.
You're welcome. Yeah. Yeah, go find him. I will need you to know your charisms. We need you. I think there's a charism for laughing at after 8 o'clock, and I think we've stumbled into that one.